the South Coastal Hockey League.
Here come the Rangers trying to make something happen. Bobby Donahoe comes in, shot, score.
Oh, what a beautiful shot.
The South Shore's premier Masters Hockey League.
Scott Kelly coming up the near side, top of the circle. Goal!
Featuring the legends.
Mike Simon go off to the net. Simon, oh, what a save by Rick Kelly. Net Brinkman gets a break, goes to the net and scores. Jerry, come on, Phantom. Oh, we'll pick it up for the Canadiens. 5:20 to go. Harnish in front. Nice maneuver. Martin scored. 9 for second after tonight is Jim Stone. What a save. Across Antoni. The shot. Oh, Jeff Holstein.
Get ready for South Coastal Hockey. The game of the week. Two teams will battle it out for a chance to hold the South Coastal Cup. Game on.
South Coastal Hockey This Week, the pregame show.
Let's join the South Coastal Hockey broadcast team and their guests for some insight into what's happening this week in the South Shore's Premier Masters Hockey League.
It's South Coastal This Week, the pregame show.
Brought to you by Fallon Ambulance. We're driven to care.
Now let's join the South Coastal Hockey broadcast team.
Okay, guys, what's up?
Two teams trying to find their identity here tonight in the South Coastal Hockey League Game of the Week as the Toros and the Crusaders square off in a Legends Division matchup. That's Bob Hainer. I'm Mark Ducharme. John Mattinson is directing us and making sure that we are well behaved on this second day of fall as the South Coastal Hockey League Game of the Week comes up next.
This broadcast of the South Coastal Hockey Game of the Week is brought to you in part by underwriting from Inkstone Printing, Commercial Printers of Brockton, Hospitality Mutual Insurance of Westboro, Fallon Ambulance, Rockland Athletic Supplies, Dr. John Parker of the Parker Chiropractic Offices in Hanover, Panera Bread, the Sunshine Pool Company of Pembroke, Frano & Frano, CPAs of Braintree,
the new Schick Hydro for your skin,
That Bloom in Place, Route 53, Pembroke, by Holly Tree Dental in Hanover, and by Stephen Lee Jewelers of Quincy Square.
Get ready for South Coastal Hockey.
It was target practice and 12 feet out tonight. It was lovely.
And it's the one and only Rick Kelly, as he will be joining us. And in the Classics Division 1 game to tell you about, Tony Rota, 2 goals. Blackhawks beat the Maple Leafs 3-2. By the way, when does Andy Pelly come knocking on your door, Rick?
He already did.
Pad. He already did.
He already asked for the old pads back. What did he? How did he do tonight?
3-2 loss.
Oh, yeah. He already asked me for it.
Oh,
God. We've already more sets of pads. We spent more money on him than the government spent in Afghanistan.
Yeah, but the funny thing is he got to be the most superstitious person in net.
Oh, very clearly.
It doesn't even matter what he does. It's snow castles. It's pads.
He came to my house when he was getting more equipment from me, and we just kept giving him more equipment and more pads, and he was in tears.
Bonto comes in. I can visualize it. That's what scares me.
What you do with his old pads?
They're sitting down in the basement of my house. It's like he was coming with methamphetamines when I was taking them away from giving the new pads. It was like it's like his dog had died, and it was just awful.
You might have a ceremony in front. In front! Oh, nice save. Bob Stafford, Paul Brinkman, who is one of the hottest players in the Legends Division. Last week, Paul Brinkman against the Saints, 4 goals in the win over the Saints 6-2. But, I mean, could you see that? You could have a bonfire in your side yard of Andy's old pads that he hasn't used.
Because those were my pads. They were like 15, 17 years ago, and I hated them, you know, and... He ended up being Andrews, you know.
Oh, that's got to be tough, Rick. I mean, I think just breaking in pads like that these days, and I don't care how light they say they make them and whatever they talk about, those things, to break in something you've been so used to wearing for so many years must be just really frustrating.
Yeah, it's pretty funny.
Anybody in that position.
Steve Colella, the new Toro, just trying to dig the puck and get it in front. Ian Murphy, the former Toro, trying to get it out. Now Jack Parsons will pick it up. Try to sneak it out to Mike Hanks. Hanks just gets it past Peter Cleary at center ice. As the Crusaders, well, they try to get it going. They're 0-3. And the funny thing is that the last two losses, a shootout loss to the Stingers and a 1-goal loss to the Whalers. So the Crusaders just can't get over the hump, so to speak. They'll try to do it tonight. Jack Parsons trying to dump it back in. Michael Hanks, as Mike Hanks picks it up, lost it. Matt Sonnabend for the Toros. Can't get it as the Toros as Colella tried to keep it in, couldn't. Now it is knocked out, and here comes Steve Colella up the ice. Picked up, Holmes digs it in front. Colella just had it go in between his legs, and he got all tangled up and trying to get the shot off and allow Jack Parsons to get there and make the play. Yeah, as icing on the play. By the way, Dave Converse and Billy Hinchy are officials, and I say that for a reason, because a Dave Converse icing call.
Early.
Pete Sato was with us many, many moons ago.
Actually, yeah, Pete probably could have actually, Parsons could have just got away with a little trip in front of the net down this end just prior to the icing, although he looked, you know, he certainly got a good chunk of Colella before he went, you know, kind of went, spun himself out of control, but Parsons easily could have been called for a penalty on that as well.
Frank Brinkman for the Toros, trying to take it off from the sideboards. There's now John Choate for Sean Regan. Regan broken up. Regan tries to go back to Richard Buckley. Buckley the first and says, Eddie Burke, take it. And Eddie Burke will snap it off down the other end of the ice. Kenny Mankello. Poor Kenny Mankello. Every time I'm at the West Coast game, I always hear one thing. Paul Brinkman on his case. Could he stop that one? Could he, if it's the game of the week, could he stop that one? Paul is unmerciful to other times. He just, you know, they're friends, and he just gets on them. As the Crusaders, John Cho tries to take it in front, knocked down in the play. Sean Regan tries to grab it in the corner. He picks it up, dumps it behind the net. Mark McGreenery tries to flick it out. As now the Crusaders with their first, having the puck in the zone, just not getting a shot off. Kaplan sends it off the boards for Regan. Regan doesn't field the pass, and here comes Artie Murphy. Artie Murphy was a number of titles with the Red Wings in the Classics division. Artie now gets the puck, rolls it in. Bob Stafford leaves it.
Bob Stafford. Nice to see Artie back after taking the last season off due to health issues. It's nice to see him back in the ice.
Artie, I've known him for a long, long time. Yes, it is good to see him back. As here comes Jimmy Ward, fires it, just missing wide of the net. I had a question to Rick Kelly sometime in this broadcast, and I got to bring it up soon, as right now Paul Brinkman offset. Mr. Kelly, does Bob Stafford get a fine from the Goalies Union because he's wearing his old Wolves pads? And Rick just smiling. He's doing the camera work for what you see on the website. I mean, the maroon and gold does not go with the purple.
He's on probation. Someone say he looked like the flag of Biafra or something.
It does. It's like 7,000 colors.
It's like
on him.
Yeah. It's like from a seventh world country.
World Cup.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. He looks like a fan of the World
Smurf
Cup.
Smurf Union.
Where's his Vuvuzela?
Somebody from Brazil that threw up on themselves.
Ward says it. Do you know something? Does he have a little flower in his lapel that, you know, somebody comes and he squirts at him?
He's not going to buy new pads. He's sure the team's going to keep him, you know?
Staff, I always love it. I love Staff. He's really, he's a Hall of Famer, and he's a good guy.
Well, Tommy got backup pads in the basement now if he wants to,
yeah,
wants to check out another pair.
You might have this might be the first Goalies Union bonfire in sometime in November if, say, if the Leafs and the Crusaders are out of the playoffs between
Staff. The way my team's going, we'll be one of the teams out of the playoffs, so.
This has got to be one of the more interesting starts. I mean, the Stingers, the only ones who can say good things about themselves, they're 4-0. Mike Simon picks it up, snaps another shot on net after having the first one blocked. The Bruins, well, they're the only other team with a zero in the loss column in the Classics division. Bruins have the Red Wings in the West Coast game.
I think this is the best front line we have out there right now. The Toros, this line here.
Oh, yeah.
Brinkman, DeGost, and Ward.
Oh, yeah.
And they're just so solid.
I will agree with that. They got to be up there because last week.
Certainly a force to be reckoned with, for sure.
Last week, in looking at the numbers, you just bring it up, they had 9 points between them in the win over the Saints. Brinkman, 4 goals. DeGost, a goal and 2 assists. James Ward, 2 assists.
We beat them week one, but I'll tell you, I must have seen 40 shots. I mean, absolutely, were flying them at me all night. They're really, really good.
You know, the funny thing is, Shoot the Puck said that the game with the Saints, they were woke up after that game. I don't think so. They just have had some tough luck. They've had some buzzards luck. They were down 4-1 to the Stingers, turned on the Jets, tied the game, and then all of a sudden, the stingers in the shootout. Mark Frano did stood on his head as it's cleared down the other end of the ice.
We talk about the give and take that Mankello and Brickman have between each other. You want to get a guy like Mankello wants to keep Brickman on his side because the way he's playing right now this season, just ask Brickman for a goal when he needs one, he's probably going to get it. I mean, these guys, Lyon and Brickman specifically, is like
like Joe Burke and Loki, exactly. Paul LeBlanc. But the thing is, Brinkman knows where the defensive zone is. Paul Brinkman needed it.
Brinkman back checks.
Yeah, LeBlanc needed a GPS system to find it. Or the one he had was out of, you know, it didn't work. It had to be taken back to Radio Shack. Colella, I'll just, you know, whatever, Best Buy, whatever. So we make all of them happy.
He couldn't triangulate. That was the trouble. He had one of the early ones. They couldn't triangulate the signal.
The trigonometry. Yeah. He didn't know what it
was. It only worked on the two sides of the red line.
We always knew he was colorblind at the Cracker Barrel. As it's rolled down to Kenny McKelvey, if you pick it up. Just don't ask him for a Slim Jim. It's still Kaplan. That is something that, dude, we all have heard about. Paul LeBlanc, one of the characters that come through the league, the all-time leading scorer for Colella. Paul was never dull, was he, Bob? Never dull.
Paul was a lot of fun.
He was a lot of fun. I'd see him out and about, and there was always something crazy that would happen when you see him. Dugout free as the Crusaders try to work it back. Brian Murphy carries it in. And gets it in on Kenny McKello, ties it up.
So the last couple of years, I mean, the Toros were a dominant team early on at the beginning of this division. And for a couple of years, they just, you know, didn't make the playoffs, and they just weren't really sticking out. But they really changed a lot of personnel, but it just shows how good they are when they turn it on.
You know, Rick, I was looking at that. Do you know, I think they might lead as far as, say, players are new to the league. That when the Legends Division came in, I was looking back, you know, how you can look back at a lot of the Crusaders, their former Leafs, Rangers, Red Wings on the Crusaders. I can only count like three players that played in the Classics Division: Artie Murphy, Radek Gaston, Dennis Yates. After that, it's more, you know, these are guys who just came in. John Choate as well.
Oh, yeah, true expansion roster.
Yeah, you know, it is
they,
true.
You know, they struggled the first couple of seasons for sure, just like everybody else, but. You know, there was a time there, and it's not too far. It wasn't too long ago that these guys were considered. Every time you played these guys, you know, you knew you had a game ahead of you, and these guys were a force to be reckoned with. I think they've won one or two titles.
Two titles,
and you know, it wasn't. It certainly wasn't by accident. They certainly had some quality players and had some quality teams put together. But they've always been, you know, this line's been a juggernaut forever. It's always been, for some reason, they can't get, you know, what they need out of the other lines offensively.
Jerry
when these guys go down or go slow, it's like they really struggle for offense.
Who's Jerry DeLuca? Oh, Red Bull.
Red Bull.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't know what it was.
By the way, he had the best shooting percentage for a while in the league. After the first games of the season, he was 1,000.
We'll call that a Red Bull going forward then.
Yeah. And you know the funny thing is, in the 2010-2011 season, Red Bull, Jerry DeLuca, had 2 goals against the Crusaders in the 6 games that they had. So he's a juggernaut against the Crusaders.
I look up the word juggernaut in the dictionary. I don't know. I think you might be kind of pushing it there, Mark.
I'm being kind to him. He's very kind.
He's shown promise against the Crusaders. How does that sound?
That's it. Rasmussen, we're trying to roll it in, had it blocked.
He's a freak when he plays the Crusaders.
Whoa, Rasmussen fired at Kenny McKellar, got a piece of it. It was right. I was going, whoa, because I was surprised it just rolled through to the net.
I don't think he was expecting that, but a good thing he had the pad down.
McGranary comes back. Toro's on the fly. Brinkman rolls it to McGranary, and nice play as he tapped it right to James Warner, buried it. 1-0, Toros.
Well, it didn't take long. We just talked about this line producing, and certainly another just a pretty play. And we did the last time we saw these guys do this earlier this year. This line continues to just great, solid, perfect bang-bang hockey goals. You know, not a lot of junk in there at all. There was thought involved in that thing. It was just perfect tape-to-tape, but staff didn't have a chance on that shot.
Mark McGranary, I got to give him the credit. You know, he just came down the middle, and he was the one who created it. The whole situation. And Ward was the third guy. It was just 3 guys crashed the net. And let's have a party, guys. James Ward has got the Toros on top. Funny thing is for the Toros, Mark McGreenery is, oh, what a feed in front! To rain the gas by Artie Murphy! I was going to comment on how the Toro scoring is sort of clustered together, but now it's changing because Ray DeGas gets his third goal of the season off an Artie Murphy feed.
Well, the scoring isn't clustered together, but the way they're with, where they're scoring from certainly is. Both those shots came from exactly the same spot on the far side of Stafford's stick. Perfect, just perfect passes to the far post. Again, Stafford had no chance on that one either.
30 seconds apart. The Toros score a pair of goals. James Ward and Ray DeGas. The line, Rick Kelly pointed out, Bob Hayner concurred, and I will concur, one of the best lines in the league, and they are showing it. And then the funny thing is, the two defensemen that are out with them were the key to set up both plays, McGreenery and Artie Murphy. As Crusaders try to work it up. Caron not able to get it through. Jerry DeLuca squeezes it out to center ice. Crusaders down 2-0 with 1:37 to go in this period. Bob Stafford has got to be going like, guys, my defense has got to be there because Jim Holmes just got the cheapest goal in the world. That was the cheapest goal you would ever want because nobody was there with Jim Holmes who just took it off the backboards.
Just keeps up staff. They just want to sit in that far post and wait for shots. You know, that third goal just came from the exact same spot the other two did as well. They're literally within 6 inches of each other. All three of those goals have been scored from.
93 seconds apart. The three goals for the Toros. 93 seconds it took them. No, we know that's not a record, Rick. I mean, 93 seconds. But it might be 93 seconds on sitting at the far post and just picking up loose change and dumping it in the bank. That's all it is. That's all. Nobody has picked up Jim Holmes. Kenny Mankello, you said it earlier. Kenny Mankello might go say to Paul Brinkman, can you get me a goal 55 seconds ago in the period? Well, Kenny Mankello, who's got his wish from James Ward, Ray DeGas, to Jimmy Holmes, they've given him a 3-0 lead to work on. And he's barely seen the puck.
Staff's seen six shots. Hey. And they get three goals. I mean, they're
50%.
That's a pretty good shooting percentage.
Great shooting percentage. Eddie Burke, the Crusaders, just right now. Whoa, what an opportunity. And Kenny Mankello just comes up big off Johnny Choate. That loose puck in front. And Kenny Mankello just rose up and grabbed it as it was heading up over his pad. Maybe I'll defer to shootthepuck.com. Maybe the Toros are waking up to playing the complete game. I happened to read it this morning. They said that the Toros woke up against the Saints. No, they were awake. They're just now finishing plays. And it's easy to finish plays and make things happen when you're down in the opponent's end half the time. McGreenery just all over a Crusader and get some help from Wayne Murphy to clear it out. This first period is going to end all Toros in 93 seconds. The Toros, as the period comes to an end, the Toros get goals from James Wood, Ray DeGast, and Jimmy Holmes and Lee, 3-0 after one. As you're watching the South Coastal Hockey League Game of the Week.
The Crusaders got to do a little better job of getting the puck in the zone and creating some traffic in front of Mankello, or it's going to be a long night for them.
You think Bob Stafford's wishing that, you know, if he came back with somebody that he could be introduced to them? Because two games we have done, as Peter Cleary will ice the puck, this is game two that we have done with the Crusaders. The other one was the Saints. So far in the game of the week for the Crusaders, they've been outscored. Now we're going into period five, 9-1 in the games on the game of the week. They don't want, they might defer. They might ask somebody else to come on for them. They're getting hammered. Paul Brinkman! He hit it up! Oh, That's in the net. Yes. Paul Brinkman drew it into the net. Paul Brinkman's looking in shock. He drew it back into the net. Brinkman is looking at James Wickle. What happened?
I mean, Kello's trying to plead his case. He knew it was behind the goal line, but he certainly got to do what he tried. But good call by Converse here, being in position to make that call, because it wasn't all the line long.
33 from 8 and 11. Wait a minute. That was 7 own goal. Mike Simon will get credit for the goal. That was just Paul Brinkman just whipped it back and bam. And I think even Kenny McKellar was shocked. That was like, that was a hard Paul Brinkman shot. Brinkman tries to retaliate and put it on the other net.
Does he get an assist on the own goal?
I know. I love it. I was talking to a soccer coach who said, he says, yeah, we've only scored 2 goals in 6 games. He says, and one of them was an own goal. The other, you know, the other team was nice to us. They put it in the net. Other than that, we've done nothing. I think, you know, Crusaders, Rasmussen took it in. Billy Hinchie, I will disagree with you. You're one of the best. That one I will disagree, because Rasmussen brought it in the zone. I mean, Montu brought it in the zone. I thought Scotty Montu kept it in the zone. So the Toros have actually scored all 4 goals, if you think about it. Jimmy Holmes got goal in this one. Late in the first period, Matt Sonnabend had set it up. As he got it off the backboards, and Holmes said, thank you for the gumball, Mickey. I'll just take care of it. Colella carries it in, top of the circle. Colella fires it wide of the net. Hanks grabs it. Hanks fans on it and allows Sonnabend to come in after it. Holy cow. 3-1 game. This hasn't been dull so far. All of a sudden picked up. As the Toros set up shop in the Crusader zone, and that will change quickly. Crusaders try to work it back up the ice. Ryan Murphy, the former Toro, had the right idea. Mike Hanks just didn't see the pass. From the blue line, Buckley shot, almost fouled it.
Oh. That was another own goal. That went up for Holmesy's glove and almost tipped right over McKellar's shoulder and into the net.
Hey, a final from Rink 2. Rangers 5, Canadians 2.
Wow.
So Canadians finally get, I mean, the Rangers finally get out of their doldrums.
So I wonder how Mr. O'Toole back on the ice as far as that goes.
You can back. He's there. He's definitely there.
He is the key. He gets them going. And the funny thing is, well, the Canadians lose. It wasn't the Maple Leafs. By the way, they get them in a couple of weeks. The Canadians get the Maple Leafs. So will the streak continue 2 weeks from now? Holmes and the Toros trying to create their own streak. 3-on-1 possibility. Holmes, just nice move, and just couldn't finish it on the back end. Our goal judge got a little too anxious down there.
I just saw that light go on.
I saw the light go on, too.
That's called the anticipation.
Well, the way it's been going so far, it's the far side.
Oh, that was good.
That was good.
I actually thought we missed something. Like, that puck went in.
You know, remember our old truck, you know, for the goof of the week? I think we retired it, though, with the Maple Leafs that night. I still remember it. The poor Maple Leaf who came to the bench to get a stick and a pulling of the goalie. Regan fires it. Jerry DeLuca knocks it down. Jerry DeLuca didn't realize he iced the puck. I watched Jerry DeLuca's reaction. It was like, why the heck did I do that? Maybe not in those terms. No, I always remember that. Maple Leaf who came to the bench, tried to get a stick, and all his teammates looked like deaf, dumb, and blind. Like, what? What do you need? And as the goal was being scored, they decided to, you know, put the game away. I always remember that. That truck got retired in a hurry after that one. For the goof of the week, or just being polite about it, is Jerry DeLuca and the Toros try to change things around. Frank Brinkman tries to block a shot from the point. Ended up screening Kenny McKellar off that good shot by Jack Parsons. John Choate got robbed towards the end of the first period. Blocked. And his attempt to clear out, Regan will end up with a deflection, dump it behind the net. Eddie Burke, Jerry DeLuca ties him up. As Wayne Murphy tries to clear it around, kept in, blue line, Mark Kaplan. Fires it, hits Currier in the shoulder. Kaplan tries to get the loose puck. As it's cleared down, Jerry DeLuca's looking at tape, Currier going, get out of my way. Poor Jerry DeLuca, he's not having a fun shift out there. This is not one of his better times.
Puck was up.
Jerry, does Jerry have us on a speaker in his helmet? Because Jerry was waving at us as he came down. Jerry coming back.
Well, we saw Minkello raise his hand. Minkello thought that puck was sitting on the back of the net and was going to get a whistle, but the puck actually fell off the back of the net and back onto the ice, and the puck was still in play, and Jerry saw his hand go up, and Jerry was just basically telling the ref, hey.
Hey.
That's what I thought
he was waving high to us.
But it wasn't.
Well, with Jerry, we never know. Stafford made sure that Frank Boykman couldn't get a rebound. 7:59 to go, middle period. Toros 3-1. We're just having a little fun in this Legends game because it has been all of a sudden picked up. Off the faceoff. Oh, what a save by Bob Stafford off Ray DeGasse. Paul Brinkman is having a good night in faceoffs. The problem was one of them he would like to have back. Ward gets spilled. Penalty coming up on Nate Rasmussen. No question about it.
That's the last thing the Crusaders need right now is a penalty.
Rasmussen will be heading into the box. Roughing on Nate Rasmussen. Legends Division winners tonight. Stingers 4-2 over the Whalers, and the Saints beat the Sharks 5-1. In this one, it's 3-1. Toros in the Classics Division. Maple Leafs fall to the Blackhawks 2-2. Maple Leafs, lowest scoring game they've had this year. And as far as goals allowed and goals for in a game, Maple Leafs have been in a lot of high scoring games as this base power play. Toro's got the people they want out there because this group got two of the three goals that they got 90 seconds in the first period. However, so far the first 23 seconds of this power play has been ugly. DeGast and Ward trying to change it. DeGast, well, he won't change it that much. He slipped and fell. Mondu knocks it down the other end of the ice. Minkello will leave it for McGreenery, and McGreenery. What the heck is going on all of a sudden?
Nobody wanted that puck.
Yeah. Minkello left it, and everybody just said, no, I don't want it. Montu's going to take off some more time. He and Mike Simon. Simon rolls it in. Minkello knocks it away. Ray DeGasse trying to knock it out. Right now, the Toro power play. Not going to be on the Tom Amansky highlight tape on how to. It's the Tom Amansky hockey version for those of you. Remember that with the old thing with Fred? Hi, I'm Fred McGriff for those Tom Amansky how to baseball videos. This is not a how to hockey video. That might not have been one of the better power plays the Toros have ever had. And just ended with 6:10 to go in the period. Rasmussen goes to the bench as Art Caron comes out, and the Crusaders do the job. Mark McGreenery. Oh, nice feed ahead. Colella is going to be called for the offside.
Wow.
Yeah. I thought that was a good pass through, but Dave Kahn, Billy Hinchin said no. And he's explaining it to Kenny Minkello. Kenny's going to like, well, wait a minute. He was here and that pass went there. And Billy says, no. And Dave Carvers comes up to Billy Hinchy and says, I had to go down and get the puck, you know.
Stop blowing the whistle.
Yeah, stop blowing the whistle. I had to go down there. I'm having fun with this broadcast tonight. This is Jack Parsons. Curls around. By the way, Rick Kelly's been snapping off the pictures. Rick will snap off some great pictures you will see on the cover page of the web. Oh, and almost Murphy nearly snuck it through for Art Caron. And Caron just couldn't get the stick around. Directed on net. Buckley, Caron, nice feed. Down low. Hanks tries to go back to the blue line. Jack Parsons. Through a crowd, Minkello pad save. Rebound, Sonnabend clears down. I noticed we're going to get the
rain.
When I'm not going to get the Rangers K Canadiens score sheet handed me because Hammer came in and I wouldn't gloat about, you know, I wouldn't let him gloat about Notre Dame being 4-0. He's mad at me.
Well, he deserves it.
Yep. When would they play somebody? I mean, I'll be happy. Michigan's going to be
Michigan was not a bad team.
Yeah, but they were 5. Alabama exposed them. Michigan wasn't playing.
Yeah, Notre Dame cracked the top 10 probably this week in national polls. That's how crazy college football is this year.
Oh, yeah.
Just a lot of movement.
There is a lot of movement. Brian Murphy is moving the puck quite well, and he can't get it through the pack as it's rolled down to the corner by the Crusaders, Nate Rasmus, and now cleared down, icing on the play for 20. And I'm saying icing because the puck had a lot of movement. It was going to make it down, and Rasmussen wasn't going to let the Toro skating with him get to the puck.
It looked like it might have actually. I thought they might have just ticked off Crusaders' boot. Toro should have gotten away with one there. But really didn't see it that way.
No. These two guys, veteran officials, and they know. There's a good feed. Regan shot near side. McKellar.
Oh.
I thought Kenny McKellar put it in the net.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that.
It's in his pad. It's in his pad.
His glove definitely came across. I don't know.
His glove came across.
Yeah.
He got it with the pad. And it's a good thing it's the pad because the the force of the Regan shot, Kenny McKellar was just enough off balance. And he put the glove in the net. Burke tries to get it off the face of. Boy, that would have been two goals that Kenny McKellar would have just gone, would have definitely not watched the second period on after this game. He would not have watched the video. Burke snaps it in. McKellar slides across. Pad save made. Frank Brinkman ends up with a rebound as he got away from Sean Regan to get it. Squeezed out as it goes to center ice by Wayne Murphy. Choke trying to come back. And they'll say Sean Regan had a big boot in the zone. Sean, who is a very tall man on skates.
He's tall, not on him.
Oh, just add the skates?
Yeah.
Marty Murphy set up the second goal for the Toros. Scored by Ray DeGas.
He's this league's closest equivalent to the Zano Chara.
Oh. We got a few people that size. Remember we had Keith Smith in the Masters and with Freddie Viola? There were some big boys in that division. 6'5", you know, they just blotted out the rink lights as McGreenery starts back. McGreenery never got control of the puck. He knows that he didn't. Would have been an offsides. Montu tries to come back, caught an edge. Wayne Murphy picks it up, dumps it in. James Ward going after it. With Nate Rasmussen and sends it up around the boards for Jerry Caron. Rasmussen will try again, but Paul Brinkman right there. Brinkman, great feed, the gas! What? Trying to shovel in the rebound, and I don't know if he's going to get it in, no.
Yeah, he got a couple, so the ref still hasn't blown the whistle yet, though.
He finally did. Dave Converse has got. Dave Converse, give him credit. I like the way he. Billy Hinchy, rather. It was Billy Hinchy. Both of them, though. I like the way they handle that because they were right there to make sure that puck wasn't covered up. Because nobody, and they also were checking too because one of the defensemen covered it up in the
Converse,
crease.
Converse was so close. I thought he was actually in the net, that he was standing right over the back of it looking for that puck. So you're right. They positionally did a perfect job on that play.
And the other part too, if one of the defensemen fell on the puck and covered it up, guess what? We get a penalty shot. As right now, Jerry DeLuca just dives and clears it away. Jerry just got it away from the Crusaders' Jimmy Donovan. Paul Brinkman for James Ward. Ward snaps it off side of the net. Ward digs out the rebound. Paul Brinkman trying to get control of the puck. As he flipped it in front, the Crusaders get it and start back as it's flipped past Artie Murphy. Picked up Jimmy Dunham, he's got a trailer coming. Murphy took it away. Murphy did a great job in just staying with the play and taking the puck away. Rode Dunham away just by just pushing him away with a stick. Marty Murphy will try to get the puck behind the net. Ward capped in. Buckley sends a knuckleball across. Ray DeGas picks it up. DeGas sends it down, and well, the Toro's going to change up anyways. DeGas just made it easier as far as the process went with 1:12 to go in the middle period. 3-1 Crusaders. All three goals span of 90 seconds.
Everybody's tongue in the Toros was hanging out of their mouth on that ship. That was a smart play to just ice that puck. Get five new skaters out there.
Holmes. And on the face-off with Brian Murphy. Murphy trying to dig it back. Colella pokes it away. Akron back out. Richard Buckley through a crowd. And Mark McGreenery was in the middle of that crowd. Blocked it, starts back. McGreenery set up the first goal for the Toros. Dumps it off the backboards. Colella gets it for the Toros for a moment. And now taken away as Brian Murphy gets it out to Akron. 40 seconds to go, second period, 3-1. Toros on top, Holmes trying to carry it in, lost it. As now Steve Colella rolls it in. And sent down to the other end of the ice. McGreenery stops it off the boards, however Mike Hanks is there. McGreenery will pick it up. And he could get a 2-on-1. McGreenery, well, he gets a break. Holmes makes a nice play in getting to the puck. 6 seconds left as it comes out. Hanks, does he realize how much time? Hanks just couldn't get the wheels going quick enough. Mike Simon scores for the Crusaders, but it's the Toros who have the 3-1 lead heading into the third on the South Coastal Hockey League Game of the Week.
Back here, Hallmark Arena after two periods of play. Shots on goal, second period. The Crusaders out shooting the Toros, 5-3, two period totals. Crusaders 9, Toros 10. The Crusaders actually did a good job of creating a little havoc last period on the Toros. And actually, Kenny McCullough came up with a couple really big saves. Otherwise, this game could have easily been, we could be looking at a 3-3 hockey game right now.
Yeah, John Choate, he made the great stop at the end of the first period. That's Bob Hayner, John Madden's directing us. Mark Deschamps, welcome South Coastal Hockey League Game of the Week, Toros Crusaders. As we get ready here in the third period, Toros will get a 4-1 lead on that rocket by Peter Cleary just inside the blue line. 12 seconds in the period, Bob Stafford screened on the play, but the Cleary rocket makes it a 3-goal Toro lead again.
Toros loving this end of the rink and loving that side of the net again, Mark, right off that far post. That was just a beautiful shot. Talk about picking a corner.
Remember last year we were complaining about all the goals down the other end? Now we get a goal judge. Our poor goal judge down the other end. He got so anxious once that he put on the light. Everything is down this end tonight. Sean Regan, well, give him some work here, but Kenny McKellar says, no. I don't like getting that tan on the back of my neck from the gold light. Staff, as he will let it go to Nate Rasmussen. Currier knocks it down. Currier set up the goal. That was just scored by Peter Cleary. That's the one thing that the Toros have had is, you know, you talk about the Brinkman line, but they have had two other lines that have always done it. Jim Holmes has been on the other line. He's come through Peter Cleary at times. I mean, they've got other people. As Wayne Murphy, a little too far with the pass to Curry, who tries to wedge it towards the net. Nate Rasmussen has the clear out pass off John Choate's stick. Artie Murphy skates back for it. 10:40 left. Toros up 4-1 here in the South Coastal Hockey League Game of the Week. Nate Rasmussen comes back. Rasmussen snaps it off. McKellar had the near side well covered. Brinkman looks, Frank Brinkman trying to clear it out, knocked down Kaplan. Kaplan tried to roll it through the middle, couldn't, gets it again. McGreenery will knock this one down after Currier knocked down the first attempt. This is Ray DeGast. Well, it's four different goal scorers for this Toros team. DeGast, McGreenery, just taps it towards the net. Bob Stafford's really, he hasn't had a chance tonight on any of the goals. DeGast stays with the play. DeGast just battles with Jerry Caron, but Kaplan comes in to help out. DeGast gets it back out. Jim Donovan couldn't get it out. Artie Murphy lines it up off the backboard side. Rebound, James Ward, right into the pads of Bob Stafford. Paul Brinkman grabs it. Paul Brinkman tries to make the move, avoids being tackled on the play. It'll be second and five coming up after that Brinkman move. Montu, DeGast. DeGast tries to roll around. Mondu knocks it down. Paul Brinkman. As Brinkman tries to get away from the Mondu. Brinkman does. Gets it out. Artie Murphy. James Ward at the circle. Fires it near side. Well covered by Bob Stafford. And Brinkman ends up with it. Paul Brinkman to Murphy. Shot deflected off the backboard. This is what we thought was going to happen in that power play that they didn't do. I think they just got... They just rested on that power play. Now they're firing on all cylinders of this shift. This has got a heck of a shift. Murphy. McGreenery. He didn't get the far corner. I don't know. That thing was a whistler to the far corner that just missed. Murphy. Brinkman hustles. Nice play by Paul Brinkman to hustle and keep the puck in the zone. And get it. Down low, it's James Ward. Ward had it for a moment. Now Caron. Tries to get it out, Montu. And Montu just says, enough!
Enough, easy enough, exactly.
Oh my God. I look back at the clock at one time, it was.
That was 2 minutes of sustained pressure.
It was.
By that one line, the puck never left the zone.
Does that count as two shifts, guys? That might, I don't know, we gotta ask Rick, who's the president of the league, does that count as two shifts, that particular segment?
Is that called stacking?
Stacking, double shifting there. The way they were controlling the puck in the zone. Still think about it. Jerry DeLuca trying to slow down the play for the Crusaders. As Brian Murphy broken up. As now come the Toros. Oh, good move, Jimmy Holmes. Holmes to the net. Bob Stafford covers up. Holmes just couldn't control the puck after getting past the
fence. Great play by Parsons to get a puck, to get a stick on Holmes before he was going in alone on staff. They got to give Holmes credit, Parsons credit on that one. Otherwise, he saved the staff would have had to come up with another big one right there.
Jack Parsons, the former Maple Leaf, part of some of those titles that the Leafs had. They've got five titles. I think he might have been a part of about four of them. Hank squeezes it up. Yeah, here comes the Crusaders as Kenny McKello is going to stop that Brian Murphy shot. No angle, really, for Murphy on that shot. As a race for the loose puck will come down the other end. Dave Congress says it's icing. We got to ask. I mean, is this a record for Dave Congress and icing calls?
We're getting there. Didn't call it, though. Hinchy called that one.
Well, Dave was down there.
Dave could have waved it off, though.
But you know the funny thing was Dave was close to the puck. That's why he would agree with it. He didn't have to come down and get it.
You get a point there.
Yeah, Dave's an excellent ref. I've seen Dave in other venues calling games. He's very good. He and Billy Hinchy are both very good. Son of Ben. Carry it in. Now we'll try a second time. Broken up in the play. McGreenery has played a very good game for the Toros. Finds Sonnabend near side boards. Squeezed it into the middle for Holmes. And Caron knocked it away. McGreenery will wait. McGreenery, nice move at the blue line. Had the right idea. Jimmy Holmes thought it was going the other side as far as the pass. And it went to the side he didn't expect it to. But Toros is still keeping in the zone because Kalala trying to dig it out. As Brian Murphy, Artie Murphy. And now cleared away as Parsons get tired of the whole thing. Nobody moving the puck. Yeah. Jack Parsons looks back at Dave Conference and says, you know, I'm tired of this.
Any votes for the Schick Hydro player of the game, guys?
Wow. Who would you pick? I mean, I can't really pick anybody. The Toros have a team effort tonight.
Yeah, it might be the whole top line of the Toros.
Oh, done a really strong job for the Toros quietly tonight is McGreenery.
He's got an assist. He set up the first goal. But, Rick, if we give you the first line to interview, you might be flinching half that interview.
That's right. Tell you, how many points does Paul Brinkman have tonight?
Brinkman? He's got one.
Just one goal?
Just an assist.
Assist, huh?
Ward's got a goal. The Gas has got a goal. It's all spread out.
Brinkman got four last week. We can't count that, right?
No. Well, then again, he's got an own goal tonight, Brinkman. He's preventing Mankello from having the shutout when he ripped it back past Mankello on that faceoff.
Yeah, so he only has 2 points tonight.
Yeah, so realistic, he's got two, one for each side. Paul Brinkman, he's a good... We'll never hear the end of that, you know. That
because we can't pick anybody else, we'll pick a guy who got four goals last week.
All right.
We'll see what happens. You know, someone could kick a field goal now and tie the game up.
Well, the Toros in their first game, Rick, were down 4-1 and came back and tied it 4-4. It was a good third period.
I tell you, when they played us, they were on fire. I was so sore the next day, man. They were ripping them at me.
They're buzzing around tonight.
No, it's the only game we won tonight. One, it was against them. And we after the game, I said, these guys are going to go a long way. And guess what? They're really doing well.
I think they just found the complete game. Everybody's cooking on all.
I want to see them play the Stingers, see what happens.
I think isn't that next? Let's see. Toros lost the Stingers in the opener, 5-4 in the shootout.
There you go.
That's 2 weeks from now.
So those are your two top teams right now.
Well, the Whalers are struggling. Saints are 3-1. They're in second, comfortably. Don't overlook the Saints.
Yeah, Saints are.
Well, they're gonna cut their, tonight. I saw those shots.
Back.
Yeah, the Saints.
They did well on the trailer tonight, getting shots from 10, 12 feet in front of me. A lot of breakaways. I had two breakaways from McNeil tonight too. Didn't score on those, but.
Ouch.
Yeah, he's so quick.
And Todd Roach is just the man. Oh, whoa. Kenny McCallum. Off that shot from the center ice by Jack Parsons. That had a dip to it.
Yeah, look what I found. It's a Tim Wakefield knuckleball, wasn't it?
Yeah, that thing was like all of a sudden it's looking like it's going over the net and went, whoa! You know, the funny thing is, we just said earlier, Rick, our guy down there, he gets a chance to be the goal judge. And he get too anxious one time. Other than that, everything's down this end tonight. Bob Stafford's.
Could have saved some payroll tonight and not have him come, right?
Well, you know, the funny thing is, Rick, do you think that Bob Stafford can request that we can move the net to center ice or something like that?
I don't care what Bob Stafford wants.
Whoa!
He's out of the union because of the pad colors. Bob, can of spray paint give it to him next week.
Give him a minor penalty next week, Rick, if he does it again.
Be out of uniform, that's right, yeah.
Well, this is how we got into the Hall of Fame, wasn't it, as a Wolf?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Sure.
Well, at least because he's wearing his Hall of Fame colors.
Okay.
not waving that one off either.
No, they're not. By the way, Rick, is this a record for Dave Converse in game for icing calls?
He's working with the referee-in-chief, Dave Hinchy, tonight, so he figured he better call him.
He better fly right.
Better fly right, otherwise he's not on the payroll next week.
4:14 left, 4-1, and it is all Toros. They have not really lit up as far as the being on the gas pedal. I'm looking down. By the way, Bob Hayner can save some ink as far as his third period goes with shots of net for the Crusaders. None.
Not that they haven't tried. But
they haven't. Yeah, they have. This line has made sure that they don't get down the other end. McGreenery slides it across. Brinkman will get a chance and has it blocked in front. Donovan will start back. And here come the Crusaders. Can they get that first shot in the third period? Simple Simon.
Actually, they've had two.
That's right. The Kenny Mankello one. All right.
The knuckleball was a save.
Yes, it was.
Well, it didn't look like one. It certainly was one.
I say Mike Simon because it's simply put, Mike Simon does so many nice things on the ice, and he does them so simple. You know, it's just so simply, it's nice to watch him. Brinkman, oh, what a fee for James Ward. He took his eyes off of it. Oh, man, was that just a great feed by Paul Brinkman. Ooh. Bob Frisoco back in voice down below us. You can hear him. The Whalers, infamous leader on defense, as now as far as Peter Cleary's got the goal in the third period and trying to give Jimmy Holmes a chance for his second on the break. Postal for Jimmy Holmes. Kalala off the side of the post. Didn't get it squeezed through. Kalala. Holmes gets a second chance. Hey, he fanned on it and he almost made a best out of it. He almost stuffed it home. Nice try by Jimmy Holmes. Cleary can't keep it. Crusaders could get a three, well, potential three on two. The other way, it won't happen. Jerry DeLuca will end up with the puck and snap it off the boards. Holmes. Head to the final 2 minutes. Sonnabend.
Stafford did a great job of playing that breakaway, Mark. He just made Holmes wait. Wouldn't make that first move, and before Holmes knew it, he had no room to make any move.
And our goal judge down the other end, because he gets a chance to turn the light on for Brian Murphy, who gets the goal for the Crusaders, 4-2 game, and we have 1:51 left.
Murphy doing a good job, a little loose change right in front of the net there, and just took it and just... top shelf it right over McKellar's shoulder.
You know, the funny thing is, it's 4-2 game. Brinkman put it into his own net, okay? So Paul on that faceoff. And Brian Murphy's an ex-Toro. So a Toro, the Toros have got to say all six goals. The four they scored and the two they allowed. That's amazing.
So it looks like number seven, Paul Brinkman, unless something changes. We'll give him credit a little bit for this week and a lot for last week.
Yes.
Okay.
Artie Murphy starts back.
I think he needs a new Hydro 5 Razor, too, so that's probably the reason we should get him to
Mark. Why not? Mark Kaplan avoids Dave Currier. And the bad part of this for the Crusaders, they can't get it out of the zone because they would love to get Bob Stafford pulled for the extra skater. Only down two, 56 seconds left. Currier. Just one good thing, Rick. It's got to be a first. We're not going to the goalies union. Kenny McKello.
That's a switch, huh?
That's it. Well, you're mad at staff.
Yeah.
And Kenny McKello, you know.
Kenny had a good game.
Kenny did have a good game. He's made some good saves. 30 seconds left.
We'll give him a raise or two.
Actually, both goaltenders played very well tonight. Staff just going to talk about just getting snake bit.
Oh, gosh, did he ever. Every time Staff looked up, there was somebody camped on the far post or something like this, a cough up right at the corner.
Three of the four goals, he didn't have a
that would have been painful.
Chance
that's quite
on ball, just due to the quality of the plays in front of him. In the fourth one, there was an own goal that he didn't expect to come to him. So.
Did Paul Brinkman have one goal or just one assist?
He had the assist.
It's
well, don't forget, he drew it back on that faceoff, and he beat Kenny McKello. And we welcome you to the SCHL Hydro postgame show tonight from the Hot Mark Arena. Toros winning their second straight game, 4-2 with Bob Painter and Rick Kelly. I'm Mark Duchamp. Welcome back as four different goal scorers for the Toros. James Ward, Ray DeGasse, Jimmy Holmes, and Peter Cleary. As for the Crusaders, Mike Simon and as well as Brian Murphy get the goals for the Crusaders. But the fact of the matter is, the Toros, when they needed to put the pressure on, they did.
Well, you talk about when they needed to. They did it in a minute and a half. They
yeah.
had three goals in 93 seconds. They had four on the night. So you talk about turning the lights on. They certainly turned on. That one shift was just phenomenal. That one shift of hockey where they just swarming and got those goals. And give the Crusaders credit for coming back and certainly making this a hockey game.
They stabilized it. And really, the Crusaders could have just been looking at 6-7-0 down in the second period. You know, Bob Stafford hung tough, as well as in the game, Kenny McKello made some good saves. And the frustrating part of this was tonight, there's some, you know, one bad goal that the Toros gave up. It wasn't Kenny McKello's fault. It was a crazy play. But we have on the SCHL Hydro postgame show, and we have a guy. We're going to reward him for last week.
We certainly are. Paul Brinkman. Paul, you only get one assist this week. Because your team really spread out the scoring, we decided to go retroactive and give you for last week. How do you feel?
That's very good. Good team win tonight. Spread it out. It's all good. Everybody's happy with a couple of wins. We've been struggling for a little bit, so good win.
I think the beginning of the year, everyone's saying, where the Toros been? Because you probably got the first, as far as your first line, the best scorers in the league. You haven't really been dominant over the past several years. Early on the league's inception, you guys were on top all the time. A couple of championships, and Ken Cole gone down a little bit.
We're getting old there.
Everybody is. No excuse.
No, we're. That's why we have Perry in the league, and people come and go, and hopefully this will start us off in the right direction. A couple of wins, we'll keep it rolling.
Some good tip-ins tonight, too, in front of Stafford, I noticed. The guys kept throwing the puck at the net and see what happens.
Yeah, we kept working hard. We were skating pretty good tonight. And like I said, walk away with a win, and we're all happy.
Rick, can we ask him about the face-off, or do we dare? That face-off he drew back.
They wonder about the face-off you drew back or your own goalie.
I just like to keep Kenny on his toes sometimes, and he admits he floats out there sometimes. So I got to keep him on his toes. You know, we were up at that point, so we had to keep him on his toes.
He wasn't getting his money worth, right?
No, he wasn't. So we got to make sure he does.
The Chicago Player of the Game, Paul Ringwin. Paul, congratulations. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Paul. I had to ask Rick because it was one of the craziest face-offs of the year.
I'm sure that they're having a little good-natured ribbing in the locker room right now about that, Mr. Brinkman, who's been in
Colorado. He's walking in with a gift bag, all the gifts and the gift certificates for being. We get gift certificates from Uno's and that blooming place and his new Hydro Razor. I'm sure they'll give him a hard time about that.
Oh,
walking in the locker room with a
good
bag.
Yeah. See, you do it for last week. You can't do it this week. Yeah, we all, the wards, the McGreeneries. I mean, hey, when you get a line like that, the gas and ward and McGreeneries. Brinkman, that's a heck of a line.
Well, he got the top on the website. He got the top thing, scoring a goal too. So it's all good for him right now.
Between them, Brinkman now has 4 goals, 3 assists. Ward has 3 goals, 2 assists, and DeGast has 3 goals and 3 assists.
There you go.
And that's after 4 weeks. That's not bad.
It's a powerhouse line. I mean, we saw, like I said, we saw him week one. It was like, wow. You know, knew they had it.
Talking about parity in the league. That's parity on their score on their line.
Yeah.
It's keeping each other in check.
And keeping the spreading the sugar
spreading
around.
I think it's them and the Stingers right now just seem to be really rolling right along.
And, when you get the second line, you get a guy named Jim Holmes who's got 3 goals. And you got 2 defensemen, Jerry DeLuca and Mark McGreenery have scored. And Artie Murphy now has 3 assists. You've got balance.
Yeah, as long as Kenny stays as good as he's doing right now, if he starts letting some softies in or something, I don't see that happening. But as long as he stays solid, I mean, them and the Stingers could be the finals. So if you had to pick it right now, it's only a couple of weeks in, but sure does look that way, doesn't it?
Hey, Classics Divisions, jump ship for a moment. Jimmy O'Toole got 3 goals tonight. That's why the Rangers get into the win column. Because he just ignites everything for the Rangers.
Yep.
There's no question about it.
Offensively, as he goes, they go. And that's we've known that for a long time. It's not surprising that back on the ice tonight, the Rangers get themselves in the win column.
The thing is, the Blackhawks are quietly 2-1-1. They don't let up many goals. They're not scoring as many goals. But the Blackhawks are just quietly climbing the ladder once again. And they're the team a couple of seasons ago,
they won.
They all of a sudden, look out, here we come.
And they've gone a long time.
They had a team, I think that season, they had a team goals against per game of under two goals a game. And in this hockey league, it's just phenomenal the way they did that. And maybe they're tightening up again, obviously, too. But, yeah, they're certainly playing the kind of hockey that we're used to seeing from them.
And guess what? We don't know what the Bruins' result is because we won't know because it's the West Coast game going on right now with the Wings. But that is the team, the Classics' best line by far. Zimmer, Martin, and Fallon.
Oh, so far, those guys are lighting it up. I'm not sure, we probably could do it, look at it quickly, but not counting tonight's games. But those guys are just on fire. Offensively, I think they're certainly in the two of them, they're top five in scoring in the league, personally. And they got another game on their belts that they're playing right now, and chances are they're going to be in the mix again, points wise.
Yeah, this league is all of a sudden. I mean, is Billy happy right now, Rick? The parity?
Well, yeah, we're very happy with the parity. Good thing about it is we didn't know what was going to happen. Try to guess early on. Nobody's ever dominant. Any team can win any night, and that's the whole goal. And obviously, it's happening right now. There's always surprises.
He just went flying to the puck. Michael Ireland, nice save.
What a
net back line. Rick Welsh in net. Barnard comes in. Barnard, nice feed in for what a save by Holstein, but it rolled over his pad and in.
Taters answer.
Michael Hanks and Dana Dolan Paney. Or check it, Tim Cruz.
Didn't miss by much either.
No, Harnish in front. Nice maneuver. Martin scores!